Welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop.
Matt's Basement Workshop is proudly sponsored by Highland Woodworking, your dependable online resource for woodworking tools, books, and supplies. With quick delivery to all 50 states, Highland is home of the legendary wood slicer bandsaw resawing blade. Visit them today at highlandwoodworking.com. Hey everybody, welcome back to Matt's Basement Workshop podcast. So as part of our Try It Tuesdays, what we have going on today is we're going to be taking a little visit back at the Woodworking America Conference in St. Charles, Illinois. And I had a chance to stop by one of the vendors that was on display there, and it was Blum Tool. Now, if you're not familiar with Blum Tool, this is an innovative new style of hand plane. Now, by new style, I don't mean like the body's all changed and everything like that. It's still, by all means, when you look at it, a regular traditional wooden hand plane with one exception. The blade and the frog are designed completely different. In fact, they're designed, the best way I can describe it is more like the type of functionality you would get with a spokeshave, the adjustability and everything like that. But the neat thing is it's a fully functional hand plane. He has jointers, he has jack planes, he has smoothers. Just came out with a block plane, as we'll see in the video itself, and it's really, really neat. And unfortunately, I think because it is so new, some people are kind of skeptical about it. But let me tell you, after you see this video, I think you'll be less skeptical about this, because I know for a fact that I am. In fact, it's one thing I've been thinking about, actually getting one of them here in the shop, because they are so neat and they work so well. And you know what, Gary was a really great guy. Now, not only does Blum Tool have these fantastic hand planes, as we'll see, but I also had a chance to film a couple other things that he has, which includes a really neat sharpening system, which is really, I think, innovative, very unique idea. And so we'll get a good look at that. And then he also has two essentially what work out to be like traveling workbenches. And as I said, we'll see more about this. I had him show me as much as possible. I think Gary got really tired of me being in the booth. So without further delay, let's go ahead and check out what Gary has to offer. And I think you'll really like this, because you know what? I'm still thinking about it today. So I'll talk to all of you later. Straight grains and sharp blades. Enjoy the footage. Okay, Gary, so we're standing in front of your full line of hand planes, and you've got everything from smoothers to jointers. And it looks like you even have block planes now also.
Yeah, these are a new addition. Just came out with these. It's a little wooden block plane.
Okay.
One of the only wooden block planes on the market.
Right. I was going to say, that's pretty unique. I don't think I've ever seen one before.
I think there's the ECE makes a little wooden block plane, mm-hmm. but that's probably about it.
Okay.
I just use the standard Stanley numbering system so people don't get confused. Everybody's used to it.
Right.
This I call a number 7. It's
okay.
A 22 inch.
All right.
This is a 6.5, and this is a 19 inch. You'd either call it a four plane or a short joiner.
Okay.
This would be a number 6 four plane, and the number 5.5, a 5, 4.5, and 4.
Excellent. Okay. Now, of course, with these being wooden bodied planes, I mean, we're all familiar with the fact that there are wooden bodied, and of course there are metal bodies. Some people prefer metal body, and people always say the weight. I don't think the weight is a real issue with it. I mean, it's light in comparison, but yet at the same time, it still would really respond quite well. And I notice here you have a little mouth insert where the blade comes through. So obviously you'd be able to adjust it if necessary, if there was any issues, I mean, with any splintering or anything. Is that the purpose for that?
Yeah, it's... This particular plane is out of mesquite wood, which is a little bit brittle, so I go through the process of inletting a Purple Heart mouth patch, which is a very fine, very hard wood.
Right.
And that's just going to protect the front of the mouth here. I do this in all my planes.
Okay.
So I think as far as wear, all my woods that I use are very wear resistant.
Right.
As far as the weight issue, I actually think a wooden plane is a joy to use, just because it is somewhat lighter than a metal plane. And
one this size metal plane, I mean, I'm a big guy. We all know for a fact they don't work out by any means, and that would exhaust me. But this one would really be comfortable to use, and you wouldn't be fatigued all the time. So you could definitely get more work out of it.
Yeah, they're a nice weight, and depending on which wood you choose, the Jatoba planes are quite heavy.
Right, you know? And that's so, this one here.
If you wanted a heavier wooden plane, you would definitely want to choose the Jatoba over, say, like a maple and cherry. That's going to be the lightest of any of my planes.
Okay. Now, can we take a look at one of your block planes here?
Yeah, this is our new little block plane. This is Jatoba for the sole and the interior. and East Indian rosewood for the side. We've got a nice, big, beautiful brass knob here. Okay. The adjustments are the same as the bench planes, only smaller.
Right. I was going to say, because, yeah, as I'm looking at each one of them, it's the same exact blade system. And as you explain, now this one, the bed can't really be adjusted, or opening.
We don't put the mouth adjusting screws in this one.
Right.
I have a nice tight mouth on it, and this is the only block plane made that has a chipbreaker on
okay.
it also. So this block plane, which is set at a 50-degree angle, actually works like a small smoother. It's a very, very nice small smoother. And because of my blade system being in there like this,
uh-huh.
rather than a big old blade sticking up like this, you're able, it's very ergonomic. You know, you can hold that in your hand very comfortably, and it really makes a great small smoother. Also.
Excellent. Yeah, wow. And again, as you said, it's very, very comfortable. And wow, that is really beautiful. Excellent. All right. Now, I noticed you have a couple other things here. You mentioned you have the torsion box and the sharpening jig. Let's go ahead and move the camera over, and we'll take a look at those,
okay.
if you don't mind.
But before we see the accessories, let's take a look at exactly how it is that we adjust a Blum handplane, because its design is so unique. You'll get a nice look at this.
This is one of our bench planes, and you can see it's a little bit different than a typical bench plane adjustments would be. What we have is a large metal frog here with a couple of studs on it. The iron is captured in here, very thin iron. And this is a backup iron that holds it in place. So that sits in there like that, and this is the backup iron. It's slotted, so when you go to change the blade, it just pulls out. You only have to loosen these three screws, and then the blade pulls out. It sits in the plane about like this. So it's at what we call a reverse angle. And typically, the blade is sticking up like this. And the frog, in reality, the blade still is at that angle. It's just the frog that sits in there like that. It has a couple advantages. It allows the chipbreaker to be a part of the frog, so there's no need for a separate chipbreaker. It's actually just the front part, the front lip of the frog then becomes the chipbreaker. And these studs are what is being adjusted here, so these two screws adjust your depth and your lateral. It's a lot like a wooden spokeshave with the twin screw adjusters on top. So each one is doing one side of the frog and adjusting it for depth and lateral at the same time. This silver star knob here, the other end of it is what goes into this T-slot. And so all that's doing is locking the frog back in place against the bed. And the procedure is just to loosen that just a little bit to take the pressure off before you adjust the two screws up here. The other two screws that you see are mouth adjusting thumb screws. And so these pegs are on swivels here. They'll swivel each way. And what that allows is it allows the screw to come back and bear against the frog on two places here. And as that is bearing against there and being adjusted, you're moving the frog this way, and that will open and close the mouth opening right here. So that's the basic system. To adjust it, you just loosen that a little bit and sight down the sole and do your adjustments and retighten, and that's all there is to it.
Okay, so now you have a bench system here. In fact, you have a couple of them. You have a small one here. Could you explain a little bit about this?
Yeah, Matt, this is our bench horse. It's a little portable workbench that we make, and it's 18 by 48 overall. We have a little handle here. When you fold the legs up, which takes about 15 seconds, you can actually carry it away like a suitcase.
Okay.
And so it's great for taking to the job site, is really what it was designed for. But I have homeowners, hobbyists buying it that want to take a bench in an apartment or in the garage, you know, where they maybe don't have a lot of room. And so it's working out really good for that.
Okay.
The core of the system is that it's a torsion box
mm-hmm.
construction. So it's a big, thick bench top. It's 1 inch thick on the outside, and the novel idea is that you can use pipe clamps and insert through the width of the torsion box every 6 inches around the entire bench in whatever location you'd want. And so, for example, here I've made a little twin screw vise, and it's just very handy. It's got tremendous clamping power because you're right in line with your screw. You're not cantilevered up like a normal vise.
Right.
So these little clamps will clamp actually tighter than a very large wooden clamp on a big workbench.
Okay.
So
excellent. Now I notice you at the end there you have a tail vise system too for this.
I've got a little tail vise. This is run with a little peg here, so that allows you to use your other holes without having to insert a long pipe all the way through, which would preclude you from using the other holes while you were using this one. So we developed this system. It's just a matter of putting the pin in the right hole for whatever length of board you've got. And there's two bushings that are in here that the pipe runs in, so it's a nice tight fit.
Okay.
And allows you to use it for a tail vise.
Excellent. Now, I noticed you actually have a regular hold down there. Now,
yeah,
so you can use that.
The bench is thick enough that a typical hold down works just great. This happens to be a Gramercy hold down, so you can give it a wrap like that. And
wow, and the bench didn't really move.
The entire bench up.
Look at that. That is very stable.
So tight.
Excellent. And then, as you said, the it folds up so you can take it with you. And where
it
so
weighs,
if you have a summer workbench area.
Oh, absolutely. Yeah, people use it in all kinds of situations where a portable bench is really the handiest way to work.
All right. Now, you have a larger size of this also, which is the one over here.
Yes. For this show, we just developed a bigger version of it. It's actually a bench horse on steroids.
Okay.
So it's the same concept. It's a 24 by 60, which gives more surface area.
Right.
And but it has the same vise system. We did make a couple changes. The top is 3/4 inch thick rather than 1/2.
Mm-hmm.
We have another bushing system over here, so you could put another vise system over there and actually make a full-width tail vise if you wanted there. We do supply it with a wooden chop, so you can make a shoulder vise of whatever width you want.
Actually. Excellent.
But this is set up for a 24-inch vise here.
And again, it's completely foldable, so you can take it where
foldable.
You need to.
You can just fold the legs up. We didn't weigh it before we came here, so I don't know what it weighs.
Yeah. Probably still lighter than me.
It weighs more than this one, I know that. But
right.
It's still portable.
Right.
It's very easily folded up and moved away.
Okay, and it's definitely sturdy. Now, one other thing I want to talk to you about, and we have that actually over here, is your sharpening box, your sharpening system. And I was watching, you demonstrated this earlier for me, funny story behind that. I'll explain that later sometime, guys. But but you're kind of showing that we can get another look at this of how you would actually attach a tool in there to sharpen, because it's much different than pretty much any of the other jigs that are out there.
Yes, because of my weird thinking, I decided why not do this upside down.
All right. I do a lot of stuff upside down and backwards.
So the principle is that the tool in this one stays stationary. We have a couple of work stops here. One is squared against the angle block, and the other one is pushed over to it. And then I have a little clamping screw here. So you can put that in there and clamp it, and it stays put. And then that allows you to use a sharpening stone on top of the jig. This has several advantages to it. It allows you to see the bevel being made. It allows infinite adjustment on your angle. The flat side of your tool is always against the flat side of the angle block here.
Right.
So it works well with short-bladed Japanese chisels.
Okay.
On a typical jig, you know, the chisel or plane iron has to stick out quite a ways, and then you have to run the roller on the stone, so it takes a fairly large stone to do that.
Right,
and
absolutely.
And get that manipulated. On mine, you can actually use a very short stone. I show this at home. I've got a broken one of these that's just about an inch square, and I can actually sharpen a chisel with just a tiny little whetstone.
Okay.
But I haven't dropped this one yet, so. you can run the stone in any pattern you want also.
Okay.
So you're not going straight back and forth all the time, so your stone doesn't need to be as flat.
Okay.
As it does if you're taking your tool and just running it like this.
Right. So you can use more of the surface of the stone.
Right, it allows a lot more latitude. I get right up on the corners, and I use the stone right out to the corners. And you can go sideways if you want. Just allows you to use the stone and keep it flatter than you can otherwise.
Okay, so that, I definitely see where you're talking about with that. With maybe even like spoke shave blades, would that work on there?
Yeah, it definitely does. It's great for short blades. It works for my plane blades. These are all adjustable, of course, and you can actually set a blade in front of those, such as my plane blades.
Mm-hmm.
They set in front, and of course this is just flushed out with the top edge just a little bit above it.
Right.
But any kind of short blade can either be clamped in between there or set in front of the work stops.
Okay. Now, one other thing you had mentioned is you can use this also for sharpening card scrapers by placing it on the side there.
Right. I've got a couple of work stops here, and by adjusting them you can take either a file or a diamond stone and get your square edge on a scraper.
Okay.
So just an easier way to get a square edge on a scraper.
Right. And then of course the main part there, you have the adjustability with the
right, here's, I don't know whether you saw this before, but here's your angle scale. And just by loosening that, the block moves and it's able to be adjusted in 1 degree increments, all the way from 60 down to zero.
Okay. Excellent.
Very, very easy to adjust the angle precisely.
Right. Now, when it comes to your blades, you also have one other jig over here, kind of a smaller one.
Yes.
It's very blade specific.
This is our fixed angle jig, and this was developed strictly for the Blum plane blades.
Okay.
And by fixed angle, one side is 34 degrees and the other side is 35 degrees. So it's very simple. You just drop the blade in there, slightly above the surface of the jig, and then use whatever kind of stone you like. I like to use a sandpaper block for my coarse honing on the 34 degree end. Then you can just turn the jig and put the blade over there, and proceed with your fine honing. Or whatever blade or whatever stone you'd like to use really works.
Very nice.
So.
Excellent.
And it's cheap. It's only $15. So.
It gets the job done.
It gets the job done. And with my blades, you never have to grind the blade. So this is the entire system that you need to sharpen one of my plane blades. You'll never have to take it to a grinder.
Very nice. One less step you have to worry
about. One less step. You don't ever have to worry about getting the angle right when you're grinding your or burning,
right.
Burning your blade.
That's all. We like it.
Yeah. There you go.
Excellent. Cool. All right. Thanks a lot, Gary. I really appreciate it.
Thank you, Matt.
Matt's Basement Workshop has been proudly sponsored by Highland Woodworking of Atlanta. With quick delivery to all 50 states, the finest woodworking tools and supplies, including their famous wood slicer bandsaw resawing blade. Visit them today at highlandwoodworking.com.